Before I give my talk, I want to say a few words about Bas Eriksoven and my relation with him. So I met Bas Eriksoven the first time in 1981 in Zoetermeer. So maybe you never heard of Zoetermeer. So Bas went to high school in Zoetermeer, and he was 18 at the time, and my parents live in Zoetermeer, and we met in a liquor store, because the liquor store had organized, it was the year of the Rubik's Cube hype, and the liquor store had organized a contest, who could do the Rubik's Cube the fastest. And Bas participated, and I participated. But we didn't know each other. In fact, we only found out 4 years later that we had been together at this contest.
And then what was the prize?
Sorry?
This contest.
The prize? A bicycle. It was a bicycle. Okay, so then... Soon after that, I finished my PhD in Amsterdam in algebraic number theory. Bas was much younger than I am, so he did his PhD later with Oort in arithmetic algebraic geometry. But Bas studied a lot, and he knew more and more about algebraic geometry and more about algebraic number theory. And after several years, Bas knew, just at least from my point of view, he knew everything. So I could always ask Bas all kinds of questions, and he would help me with everything. For instance, the lot of the group scheme things that I picked up later, I learned from Bas. But occasionally, so I asked Bas lots of questions, and one of the questions I asked him at one point was about an algorithm. I had found an algorithm to count points on elliptic curves over finite fields to compute, and if you have an elliptic curve over Q, then you can say, well, it is an algorithm to compute the Fourier coefficients AP of the corresponding modular form. So, and since for every weight 2 modular form over Z, there is an elliptic curve over Q, you can say, well, this is also an algorithm to compute Fourier coefficients of modular forms of weight 2, at least when the coefficients are in Z. And nowadays, it can also be done more in general. So I asked Bas whether he thought you could find a similar algorithm. This algorithm, moreover, is polynomial time and deterministic, the best you can have. And I asked Bas if he could generalize this to higher weight. And then the example would then be the Ramanujan tau function, to compute the Ramanujan tau function in deterministic polynomial time. And this, in fact, worked out. Bas picked this up. He liked the question, and he told me later that he actually liked the question because I said on top of that if you would have a similar algorithm for modular forms of half integral weight, where the mathematics is completely different and there is no such algorithm, but who knows, we can dream, then you could compute class numbers of imaginary quadratic fields, because there are modular forms of weight 3 over 2 whose coefficients are Hurwitz class numbers of imaginary quadratic fields, and that would be extremely interested. And I said, and it is well known, if you can compute class numbers of imaginary quadratic fields very quickly, then you can factor the discriminant also very quickly. You would have a factoring algorithm. And I think Bas told me later that he really liked that idea, so he looked into it. But then it turned out that my method and his method, you don't compute Fourier coefficients AN, but only AP. And so before you can compute the class number to factor N, you have to factor N to compute the class number. So Bas teased me with this several times after that. My only defense is that once I gave a talk about this and I mentioned this, Birch immediately said, but then you can factor it with such an algorithm. So he made exactly the same observation. So I was in good company. So that is what I wanted to say about Bas. So let me now then come to my talk. So this is, since the talk was rather, the title was rather long, I made it shorter and I omitted one word. So the the group schemes will also be always commutative. So finite flat commutative group schemes over Z. So let me first say a few introductory things about group schemes. So we have a group scheme, a scheme G, and then it typically has points that have coordinates in some ring. And then the points are satisfy certain equations. So there are equations F1, a number of equations that generate the ideal of equations. The points of this group scheme are the solutions of these equations, and then there is a neutral element, of course, a special element with the coordinates in Z, if the group scheme is over Z, and there is a group law. So you have certain formulas, and they are polynomials. They are polynomials in 2n variables that give you the group law. And what does it mean to be finite and flat over Z? It means that if you look at this algebra, first of all, it means that the coefficients of the polynomials must be ordinary integers. And then if you make the algebra X1 xn modulo f1 up to ft, and this is a Z algebra, and you want this to be finite and flat over Z. So it means it is finite and free. For Z, but people always say flat, but for Z it just means free. So it is finite rank and free over Z. That is what finite flat commutative group scheme is. And the commutivity means that the polynomials H1 up to Hn are symmetric in the input points. So let me give you just one example. So if you're used to elliptic curves, it is just like an elliptic curve. You have points that satisfy equations and formulas to add the points. Except that this is much easier because this is finite. This is a zero-dimensional thing. So here's an example. Oh no! Before I give you an example, let me introduce notation. Then, so if I take any ring, I can consider the points in that ring. So if R is a ring, then I can consider GR, which are the points with coefficients in R that satisfy the equations. And then this is a real group, a normal group, a commutative group. And of particular interest is GQ bar. So they are, in some sense, all points, the group of all points. So here is an example that I like. So here is the points have only two coordinates, X and Y, and they satisfy the following equation. X squared minus X is 0, and Y squared minus 1 plus 2X is also 0. So this is a finite of rank 4 over Z, you see? And you can compute the points with coordinates in Q bar. X is either 0, in which case Y is plus or minus 1, and or y is 1, no, x is 1, in which case y is plus or minus I. So there are four points, you see? So in this case, this is a group of four points. And you see it is also a Galois module. The Galois group permutes the points because the polynomials have coefficients in Z. So this is also a finite Galois module. Oh yeah, I give you the group law. Here's the formula. Of course, you want to try to add two points. So if I take x, y, and I sum it with x prime, y prime, the following formula does it for you. X plus x prime minus 2x, x prime, y prime times 1 minus 2x, x prime. And you can see the neutral element is 0, 1. So this is like an elliptic curve, except there are only four points, and it's all very finite. Okay. Now there is also a notion of a simple group scheme, and that means that, so a simple finite flat group scheme G, it means there are no proper closed subgroup schemes. And fortunately, this you can see that on the Galois module. The G is simple if and only if the corresponding Galois module of points is irreducible as a Galois module. So that means it's the same as saying GQ bar is irreducible, so there are no proper sub Galois modules. Okay, now there is a paper by Tate, 1966. Tate wrote a paper on p-divisible groups in the Driebergen conference. This paper was in English, and in there, Tate describes the theory of group schemes. It's a very nice article, very introductory. And he asks he has a conjecture on what or a question rather, about what the simple group schemes over Z are. So let's look at that question. So you can draw a few conclusions. So if G, so let's say finite flat over Z. Suppose it is simple. That means then that it is killed by some prime. Because it is finite, it has to be killed by something, and since it is simple, so there is a prime number P that kills G, either the group scheme G or the Galois module that is equivalent. And so that means that this Galois module is actually a finite dimensional vector space over FP with continuous Galois action. It's a representation of the Galois group in this vector space over FP. And if the representation is irreducible, the group scheme is simple. So here are some examples of group schemes that are simple. Oh, I should say this, examples of group schemes that are simple. So here there is, for instance, the group scheme of pth roots of unity. So mu p, I tell you what the points are. The points are the pth roots of unity. So the zeta in q bar with pth power equal to 1. And you can actually write down the algebra very, very easily. The algebra is given by Zx modulo the character, this equation. And the neutral element is 1, and the formula for multiplying is just multiplying. So this, and this is simple because the order is p. Oh, that you can, that is also something maybe I should say, is that the order of the group of points of any finite flat group scheme over G is equal to the rank, the Z rank of the algebra. That is because the finite flat group schemes over characteristic zero fields are etal, and therefore you have as many points as you have in the rank of the algebra. So in this case, this cardinality is a power of p, and in this very example, the cardinality is p, and therefore it is simple. There are no modules here. So this is an example of a simple group scheme. And you can make another one. There is a notion of Cartier duality of group schemes. I will only say what it is for the, so if you have a group scheme G, you can associate to it its Cartier dual, and if you do that again, you get G back. It's the Cartier dual, and I will tell you what the points are without telling you what the algebras are. The points of the Cartier dual of a group scheme are HOM GQ with values in the pth roots of unity that's what it is. So yeah, I do it. I say it a little bit better. To GM, let's say to GM, and GM is the. I can say it like this. I think it is just this, but with the natural Galois action here and the natural Galois action there. Yeah, thank you. G of Q bar. Yeah, of course, the values of all these homomorphisms are roots of unity because it's finite. So that is the Cartier dual, and if you compute the Cartier dual of the cardinality or the rank of the dual is equal to the rank of the group scheme itself, that follows from this formula. And the Cartier dual of mu p is the constant group scheme z mod p z. So I will not write down the algebra for you, but it has trivial Galois action that follows from this formula. Now the homomorphisms from mu p and mu p, that has trivial Galois action. And so this has trivial Galois action. So those are two examples of simple group schemes. And Tate asked the following question. So now we go back to Tate. Tate in 1966 asked, are mu p and zp z the only ones, the only simple group schemes over z? And it is really a question. And for many years I thought that everybody expected the answer to be yes. But some people have been trying to convince me that is way too soon to think that in fact it may well be false. And so let me sketch to you what is the situation, and maybe then you have your own opinion. Okay, so that was Tate's question. And what is true, what Tate could prove, is that the ones of order p, the simple group schemes of order p are always, no, group schemes of order p are always simple, and those are the only two. This is the content of the famous Ort-Tate paper. So if the cardinality of G is p, and G is, then it follows immediately that G is either Z mod PZ or it is mu P. So there are only those two. And nowadays we can prove actually that the cardinality of G cannot be P squared if G is simple. There are no group schemes finite flat over Z of cardinality P squared that are simple. And let me sketch you the argument. So you need to know one thing about the points, that if I adjoin the points of the group scheme to Q, then I get a Galois extension. And this Galois extension, just like for elliptic curves, it is unramified outside the bed primes and the primes that divide the order. And there are no bad primes, because the group scheme is finite and flat. So if I take G, cardinality of power of P, then this is Galois and unramified outside P. And now suppose I have a group scheme of order P squared that is simple. Then the underlying vector space is of dimension 2 over FP. And I can look at, so I have this Galois representation, Galois Q bar over Q goes to GL2FP. And I can look at the determinant. And then the determinant, that goes to a commutative group. And so the determinant factors over the Galois group of Q zeta P, the here. So that follows that the determinant is a power of the cyclotomic, of the p-th cyclotomic character. It is only ramified at p. And I claim that it is actually the speed cyclotomic character. And to see that, we look locally. So let's look locally over ZP. Then maybe it is not irreducible anymore, the Galois action. And there are actually two possibilities. It is either an extension of two groups of order P. So G is an extension of two groups of order P. And they are also over ZP, necessarily mu P or ZP. The Ortay theorem also gives you this result over ZP. Or G is order P squared, and it is simple. Well, in the first case, there are three possibilities, or four, mu P, ZP, ZP. And it cannot be an extension of ZP by ZP, because ZP is an étale group scheme with trivial Galois action, and it would then G would be étale, and I would have an unramified Galois extension here, and that is impossible. It is necessarily trivial, and the same for mu p and mu p, because then I look at the Cartier dual, which is ZP and ZP. So the only possibility is something like mu p G ZP. Or vice versa, but the vice versa one is always split by the connected component. And now I can compute the determinant, you see? Here the action is via the cyclotomic character, and here the action is trivial. So I see that the action is through matrices of this form, and the determinant is the cyclotomic character, okay? So here we have the cyclotomic character, and if it is order p squared, then we have a pp group scheme in the sense of Renault. And then if you make a base extension, you can write it as theta to the p. And then the determinant is the p plus first power of theta. And theta is the fundamental character of level p squared. And then the p plus first power is exactly the cyclotomic character. So the determinant is, and which is the cyclotomic character. So in both cases, we have the cyclotomic character. And that means this representation is odd. No, minus one goes to, the complex conjugation goes to minus one. We have an odd representation. And then there is Serre's conjecture, which has been proved. And in fact, in this particular case, in the unramified case, it was proved by Carré a little bit before the result with Wendt-Berger. And Serre's conjecture holds. And what does it say in this case? It says that there should be a cusp form in for the group SL2Z of which weight? Well, the weight should be, this is omega to the weight minus one, right? So the weight should be two. So there should be a weight two cusp form for SL2Z. And that doesn't exist, as we know. So therefore, the representation is reducible. Yeah? So there are no group schemes of order, simple group schemes of order p squared. And this is already quite a difficult theorem to, it seems difficult to generalize Serre's conjecture to three-dimensional representations, let's say. Now, another thing that is known, that is for small p. So there is the, for small p, no, simple group schemes have order the power of p, and you can look one p at a time. And there is the famous result by Fontaine, and independently, and more or less at the same time, Abrashkin, that they prove that there are no abelian varieties with good reduction over everywhere over Z. But this is actually a consequence of this theorem, that for PS3, the only simple group schemes are Z mod 3 and mu 3. And in fact, they prove a little bit more. They prove that for primes less or equal to 17, the only simple p power order group schemes over Z are our old friends mu p and Z p z. So one of those primes was enough to prove that there are no abelian varieties with good reduction everywhere. And so the question is whether this is always the case. And let me, before I go into this a little bit more, let me say one thing. What about other number fields? So other number fields. Well, then it is false, very much false, for two reasons, sort of. The classification of Ortaedt, the Ortaedt classification that for Z gave us only those two group schemes, depends on the factorization of P. So it depends on the factorization of P, if we call the number field F, in the ring of integers OF. And the more factors you have, the more possibilities there are for the group schemes. It can be locally in any point Z mod PZ, or it can be mu P, and they can glue together in different ways. And since for every number field, there are infinitely many primes that are totally split, we see that there are infinitely many primes for which there are many more group schemes than only mu P and Z mod P. So that is one reason. And another reason is that one way to make such finite flat group schemes is to take an abelian variety with good reduction everywhere and take the p-torsion. So then the p-torsion is a finite flat group scheme over the ring of integers. And if you're lucky, the Galois representation is irreducible. And that can happen. There is a famous example by Serre in his Inventiones paper in 1972, where A is an elliptic curve over the Q square root 29. And in that case, for most primes, for almost all primes, except three, I believe, the groups, you have an irreducible Galois representation on the p-torsion, and therefore a finite flat simple group scheme over the ring of integers. But over Q, there are no elliptic curves with good reduction everywhere, so we cannot do this game, and we cannot do this game either. So over Z it could be true, but over number fields in general, it is false. Okay, well, the result that I want to talk about today is a little bit just one little step further than the Fontana-Braskin theorem. This is a result together with Lassina-Dembele. We prove it also for 19. Also, let me make it short, also for P is 19. We only have Z mod PZ and mu P. And I'll sketch you the proof, how we do this. And in fact, we follow the same route as Fontaine and Abrashki. Sorry?
How old is that?
How is?
From when is that result?
Oh, 85. Okay, so let me sketch you how to prove this. So the first thing you do. So here's the proof. So I take a G over Z, simple, and the order of G is, so G is killed by 19. G is killed by P is 19. And I assume it is simple. So it could be a 100-dimensional irreducible Galois representation. And the first thing I do is I take k to be the field that that I get by adjoining the points of G. And I'm going to study that field. And we know about this field, is, and I mentioned this already, that this is unramified outside the critical prime, which is 19. But it is also very modestly, very little ramification at p is 19. Now the that's because there is good reduction everywhere. I guess the representation is crystalline or something, so there is very little ramification. And let me make that explicit. So in order to quantify that, I look locally. So I look over ZP, and then I make this. I take in general a Galois extension. Let me call it maybe F Galois extension, finite Galois. And then you can measure its ramification in several ways. So one is the ramification index. And another one is that you can observe that the ring of integers of a p-adic finite extension of QP is monogenic, so it is generated by one element alpha. And you can look at the valuation of a sigma alpha minus alpha, where sigma runs through the Galois group, and I don't take it the identity, then I get a number, which is a rational number. Yeah, that's what I want to say. Sorry, thank you. OF is ZP alpha. Thank you very much. And this now is not an integer, but it is contained in 1 over E Z. And then another quantity that you can look at is the different delta. And I can look at the valuation of delta, and if I normalize my valuation such that V of P is 1, then V of delta is also contained in 1 over EZ. So those are all quantities that measure how ramified this extension is. And the last one that I need is the sum of those two. So I put U. So U depends on F over QP, U. It is the sum of I and the valuation of delta. And this is, in fact, the quantity that occurs when you look at the upper numbering of the higher ramification groups. So this means precisely that the G of J is trivial for J larger than U. And U is minimal with this property. But this is a way to introduce the quantity without talking about higher ramification groups. And this also has the property that it is compatible under composition. If you have two fields that have a certain U, then their composite has the max of those two U. And that means that, in fact, now I mention, so why does this quantity appear? This appears in the theorem of Fontaine and Abrashkin. It's always the same paper. They say that if you have G finite flat, and it is killed by over Z, and it is killed by P, it doesn't need to be simple, it's killed by P, and if I take K, the field that I get by adjoining the points of G, then the U, and I actually mean the U of the completion at any of the primes over P, then the U is bounded. It is 1 plus 1 over P minus 1. That is what the Fontaine-Abrashkin theorem is. For instance, if you take G as mu P, then the field that you get are the P-th roots of unity, and then you can, in fact, compute easily. You can compute E, you can compute I, you can just compute everything. And you find that U is 1, which is always the case if the field is moderately ramified. So this is at most. So you see it is only slightly more, it can be. So rather than considering K that is generated by the points of G, I consider a slightly larger extension. So K now is the maximal extension with that property, that U is at most this, and it is unramified outside P. And that definition makes sense. So K is a maximal extension of Q, Galois, that is unramified outside P, which is 19 in our case, and U, for all the primes over P, is at most 1 plus 1 over P minus 1. And this is well defined, this field this exists. And now there is a consequence of this U that maybe I should mention, because of the you see that the valuation of the valuation of the determinant of the difference is did I say it so? Oh, there it is. It is less equal to U, you see? It's strictly less than U, because I is one positive. And this has a consequence for the root discriminant, or the root number, as Samuel said. So if you take the root discriminant of K, I mean of the global field K, the root discriminant, so that is the discriminant of K to the power 1 over D, where D is the degree of K. This root discriminant is actually equal, well, it is at most, if you work out the relation with the local difference and the discriminant and the root discriminant, you get that this is smaller than P to the 1 minus 1 over P. This follows from this. This implies this. So you get a bound, upper bound on the root discriminant of that number field, this number field there. And now there are bounds that translate these bounds on the discriminant in bounds on the degree. So these are called Odlyskow bounds. And it looks like this. You have here you have the discriminant of the number field, 1 over n. Oh no, sorry, this is the degree. The degree goes here. And here the root discriminant go of all number fields. And then there is a graph like this with an asymptote. But this is a little bit too much, like this. And the asymptote is that here. And this is function, let's call it h of n. Then Odlyskow says that the root discriminant of h of d, the root discriminant of a number field is at least h of d. This is the kind of result you get also out of Minkowski bounds, but this is much, much stronger. And the asymptote is at 4 pi e to the gamma, which is approximately 22.281616. So that's where the asymptote is. And we have this bound on the root discriminant. So in our case, the root discriminant is at most 19 to the 20 over 19. Of course, if the root discriminant is higher than the asymptote, you don't get a bound. But if the root discriminant is somewhere here, then if it is here, then you get a bound. And in this case, this root discriminant is equal to 22.18484. So you see it is a little bit smaller than this, but it means that it will cut the graph very far out, and the bound will be big. And this is maybe the reason why Abrashkin and Fontaine just didn't bother to do 19. But Lassina, he is not afraid of these numbers when they get large. So what bound do you get? You get a bound. So you get a bound, and what you get is this field K. So I just erased it here, but that was the maximal extension unramified outside P with this bound on the ramification at P. The degree is at most 7, 6, 7, 6, 6, 9. This is bigger, but it's even bigger, 8, 1. This is the bound, so about 80 million. And we can do a little bit better, so we have Q zeta 19 inside that field K, which is the maximal field with certain property. And this has degree 18. And in fact, this degree is at most, it's a little bit smaller. It's less than, 426499, half a million. Now, in all the examples that were done by Fontaine and Abrashkin, the bound was typically less than 60. And then they would say, this is a solvable group, and I can use class field theory to sort of figure out what the extent. Oh, let me make this remark. It suffices to show that this is actually 1, that K is equal to Q zeta 19. Because once I know that the Galois action factors through this Galois group, since it is irreducible, and this is P minus 1, it splits into a product of one-dimensional eigenspaces, and by simplicity, it has to be one of them. And then by Oort-Tate, it is either mu P or ZPZ. So that it suffices to do that. So because the 19 minus first roots of unity are in the... it doesn't matter. It suffices to prove this. Okay, so we have a bound of half a million, and the goal is to reach 1. Okay, well, here we are. We have Q, we have Q zeta 19, and then we have K, and this is a Galois extension. And it can be filtered with the Jordan-Hölder filtration with simple sub-quotients. So I know that there is a field here, maybe E, such that this has Galois group gamma, and this is a simple Galois group. So we know then that, now I write down some things about gamma, so we know that the cardinality of gamma is at most the degree, which is half a million, 426499. Now, what else do we know about gamma? Could it be cyclic? Well, if it is cyclic, it means we have an unramified, we have a cyclic extension of Q zeta 19, which is almost unramified. It is unramified outside 19 and very little ramified at 19. And since the class number of Q zeta 19 is 1, it cannot be unramified, so it must be ramified. And then the conductor can be at most pi squared, where pi is the unique prime over 19. And that ray class field is trivial. You can compute it. You write down cyclotomic units. So there is no abelian extension inside here. So that means gamma is not commutative. And now we say, could it be tame? Could it be tame? No, it couldn't be tame. If this is a tame extension, if this is tame, then the Odlyzko bounds, immediately kill this the situation. If it is tame, then the root discriminant gets much smaller, and then in fact you find that this is less than 60, and then we are done, because then it is solvable. So it is not tame either, not tame. And that means that the cardinality of gamma must be divisible by 19. There must be ramification of degree 19. So 19 divides the cardinality of gamma. Okay, so what we have here is that gamma is a simple group that is ordered at most half a million. It is not commutative, and its cardinality is divisible by 19. Well, there are very few of those groups, and you can actually list them. You do not need the full classification of finite simple groups for that. You can find papers in the 60s where people already knew how to go up to a million. And it is my impression that it is even easier than that, because in those papers, groups that have order, smooth group order, the powers of 2 and 3 and 5, they are the difficult ones. And such a big prime should make it very easy. But I don't know, I'm not an expert, I don't know how to do that. Anyway, there are three groups, possible groups. Gamma is either PSL2 F19, or it is PSL2 F37. Because 38 is divisible by 19, or it is Janco's first simple group, Janco 1, the first sporadic simple group that was found in the 60s. And the cardinalities of these groups are rather large. The cardinalities are, 3420 for PSL2 F19, 25308 for this one, and Janco is 175560. So it would be great if we could find a representation, no, unramified outside 19. That acts through the Janco group, but unfortunately it's not like that. It doesn't exist. So what? Once you have this, so those are the possibilities for these groups. It implies in particular that E is Galois over Q. Which one did I switch? Oh yeah, there's a number missing, sorry. There is a zero somewhere. Let me see where. Here. Okay. So that means that E is Galois over Q, because if it would not be, I would be another, I would have a conjugate extension, but also with Galois group gamma, and that would all sit inside K, and it would be too big. So the reason is that this is less, that is bigger than the square root of half a million. Okay, and now the proof proceeds as follows. Now I recompute the root discriminant of E, and we get something that is slightly smaller. And then we reapply the Odlyzko bounds with this smaller root discriminant, and then we get a contradiction. Then the extension has to have very small degree. And to recompute it, we look locally. And locally, we know that the wild ramification group is a normal subgroup of the local Galois group. So the local Galois group, the Galois group locally is contained in the normalizer, of the 19 Seeloff subgroup of gamma. And now you need to know, I forgot to say that, a few more things about these groups. So if you look at those groups, it is very easy to see that the cardinality of every 19 Seeloff subgroup is 19, and they are all equal to their own centralizer. So you can, that is an exercise for these two matrix groups, and Janco spells it out, and it's even easy to prove for Janco. And when you know that, then that means that the index of the 19th Silov subgroup in its normalizer is at most 18, because it is, this implies that the index of the local Galois group in its 19th Silov, now it acts by conjugation, and there is no kernel because the centralizer is itself, so this is at most 18, it divides 18, which is the order of the automorphism group of the 19th Silov subgroup. So you know locally quite well what is going on. You have QP, zeta P, P is always 19. Then there is an extension of degree D, where D divides 18. You get a field E prime. And then there is a field E, and this is wildly ramified. And now you recompute the root discriminant. You prove that this is actually an unramified extension. It's a little exercise in Coomer theory. So this is unramified, this is tamely ramified, this is only a little bit ramified, and you get a better bound on the root discriminant. And that better bound gives you a better bound on the degree, and the conclusion is then that gamma cannot exist. And that finishes the proof. You cannot go further than this, than 19, because from 23 on, you are higher than the asymptote. But you could do that with Odlyzko's GRH bounds, the bounds under the under the Riemann hypothesis. That would bring you up to 37. And then from 41 on, there are no results. So that's it. Thank you.